Serena Dalena here today from PRL. She will tell us a bit about what's happening behind the doors of PRL.
Mm-hmm.
She has a PhD in complex systems, and she has been applying this to space physics, you say, looking at particle dynamics, field mm-hmm. dynamics, and these kind of things. And then you're also an accomplished dancer.
Yeah, I studied dance for quite a number of years.
She's been doing kickboxing as well.
So yeah.
I'm just
Thank you. Hello, good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for being here. So I'm Serena. I work for Physical Review Letters. I started as associate editor in 2013, so this is my fourth year. I have PhD. I mean, my research was mostly focused on particle acceleration in presence of turbulence in the solar corona, solar wind, and the magnetosphere. And this is what I was doing before working for Physical Review Letters. So my talk will be like a bit of, I'll talk about maybe the journal, the history, so the review process, my job, how we select referee, how do we highlight paper, and I'll show you some metrics, statistics of journals or scientific journals. So. The physical review letters are published by the American Physical Society. The APS is a non-profit organization. This means it is community-driven and driven by physicists. We are not a commercial publisher. The headquarters of the APS is located in College Park, close to the University of Maryland, while the editorial offices have been historically located on Long Island. In front, basically, of BNL, Brookhaven National Labs. We have quite good collaboration with scientists there. Come and visit us quite often, and we go there for talks, seminars, and other things. So it's a kind of a long drive from Manhattan. It's like 1 hour and 30 minutes in good traffic condition. That is basically very, very rare. So it takes 2 hours, usually. And so the APS was founded in 1899 by 32 physicists at the Columbia University that gathered there at that time. And since then, our mission has been to advance and diffuse the knowledge of physics, and we do this in several ways, like mostly organizing, of course, scientific meetings. So the largest one is the March meeting that includes topics like condensed matter, soft matter, quantum information, statistical physics, and so on. Then we have the April meeting for astrophysics, and DPP for plasma, DEMOP for AMO. And we have also topical meeting for topical groups, of course. And we support minority in science, women in science, do lobby for the Senate. So we are involved in a quite number of activities. But mostly, we diffuse the knowledge of physics, publishing 14 journals known as the Physical Review Family. PRL is the flagship journal of the APS. So these are the number of papers that the APS receive usually. This is still 2012, but here, let's say that this curve remains quite flat. So we receive around 40,000 papers per year. This means really one submission every 3 minutes. And although we are a quite small society, being nonprofit, and we publish just physics, we cover 3% of all physics journals in the world and 15% of all physics articles. The organization is quite international, and the editors come from all over the world, particularly from 30 different nations that are the country of origins. And this is really done on purpose to reflect the international character of the physics community. And we have other 100 people as a support staff. Instead, Physical Review Letters was established in 1955 by our first editor, Sam Gunsmith, that decided to collect all the letters that were arriving to the Physical Review, that at that time was just one big journal. And he wanted to create a standalone publication, a standalone journal, with the aim to provide fast publication to very important results in physics, and to also promote cross-fertilization among the different fields in physics. So this article appeared in the first volume of Physical Review Letters, and through my talk you will see some really this yellow highlight articles that have been then recognized with the Nobel Prize in Physics for one or more author. We collect all these papers together, and our collection is called the Milestone, and we keep it updated like yearly. All those papers that are fundamental for the history of physics are made free to read for the public, for everyone. And so we actually usually do encourage, you know, professor to encourage themselves, students, to check this article instead of checking the textbook where the physics is usually described. But it's a nice way to introduce students and young researcher in how we basically diffuse or communicate our result in science. So this is who we are. We are in total 19 full-time editors like me. So we are all PhD in a different field of physics because we need to cover the different area of the journal. We definitely, at the very least, one postdoc experience. Then we have also three adjunct editors that cover very specific topics of the journal, like biophysics, quantum information. Our new lead editor Hugh started 3 months ago is Hugues Chatet from University of Saclay in France. His expertise area is soft matter and statistical mechanics. He replaced Pierre Maestre, that now is the editor-in-chief of the American Physical Society. And to complete the team, we have count more than 100 divisional associate editors. So these people are members of the community, are active researchers, were recognized by the community, and they help us at different stages of the review process. Like at the beginning, when we make an initial evaluation about the article, so we decide if we want to send the article out for review or not. So we may ask them like informal advice that we usually send to the authors, or ask for a referee suggestion. We consult them in the middle of the review process, especially when we have like very conflicting reports at the end, and we would like another additional informal advice. But most of the time, they handle the appeal. This means that the review process ended like with a recommendation against publication in Physical Review Letters, and the authors can appeal this editorial rejection. So the all correspondence is sent to these people. They have access to the full file of the paper. This means the reports. They know the identities of the referees. So they make sure that the paper, the authors receive a fair hearing, and that there were not strange things during the review process. Maybe we consulted someone that was strongly biased or was really a competitor without knowing. And they do this work on a completely volunteer basis, and it's so a huge, huge service that they do to the community. So, as I said, Physical Review Letter is the flagship journal of the APS and is the most important journal in physics, in the letters journal in physics in the world. We publish, as I said, letters, so they are a short report of covering the full arc of physics, so from fundamental physics to interdisciplinary physics. And our motto is to move physics forward. So this is what we ask the author to explain, how their paper is likely to move physics forwards. This is the question that we ask, usually ask the referee. And this is another paper that appears on the first number of Physical Review Letters, the discovery of element number 102 by yours. So in 2014, we published the discovery of the element 117. So somehow, in certain field, we are successfully advancing physics forward. How do we select those papers? So, in order to be published in any scientific journal, a research must be scientific valid, so there shouldn't be obvious mistake, and it should be novel, so the result shouldn't have been published in other journal before. So to be published in PRL, usually a paper has to meet one of those four criteria that are quite known by the community and are substantially advanced a particular field, open a significant new area of research, solve a critical standing problem, and be of great general interest. So one criteria is enough, in the sense that if we have a very important result that is focused in a particular area, of course, we want to publish that result. And we like to synthesize this four criteria, usually with the word of impact, innovation, and interest. So in terms of number, this is how we look like. So here you have the number of papers submitted to most of the physical review journals. So these are like ABC. This is PRB in red. This is the largest in terms of paper published journal of the APS. And PRL is in orange. So on average, I mean, PRB cover all condensed matter. So on average, you can see that a journal that publishes physics receive like around 6,000 papers per year. We receive almost 11,000. So it's really, really a huge amount of work. Usually, full-time editors handle between 700 and 800 papers per year. And because of this, we do a pre-screening of our work. We do reject some paper out without review, as I explained before. The authors, of course, can always come back and motivate better their result, and we can reconsider. But still, 70% of the papers are judged by the scientific community. They are sent out to review. And we have an acceptance rate of 20%, so we usually publish around 2,500 papers per year. That is a quite good size. And we are the most cited journal in physics in the world. If you do the maths, this means that every 80 seconds and one cite a PRL, so that is quite good. So basically, we try to be like selective, but not too much. We still publish a very good number of papers because we want to give a broad selection weekly in all the area of physics. So, and we are letters, but what happens if your result is too long and you have extra material? So you have actually three options, because I listed all just two, but the old school style that I kind of like, actually, is the one they prefer the most, is that when you see a letter, usually, you know that there is a longer follow-up paper coming. This was the general idea. But, of course, you can use supplemental material. Especially, so the letter should be self-contained. This means that a reader should be able to reproduce your result from what is written in the letters. But things that are really technical, like further validation of a numerical code, things that the referee asks of about an experiment, so on, they can go in the supplemental material, so things that are of interest of the specialized reader. And we actually also encourage simultaneous submission and submission of physical review and physical review letters for possible simultaneous publication. So when you do that, you just prepare the two articles, submit at the same time the two journals, the letters and the, you know, the appropriate physical review, and you write two cover letters for the journal explaining the author, the editors, that this is what you want to do. And so we coordinate the review process. Most of the time we select the same referees, and of course acceptance of the letters of the longer paper doesn't guarantee the acceptance of the other, but usually this is very nice, because when these two papers get published, they're also linked on our website, so they cite each other, and someone that is checking the letter of the longer paper has easy access to the others, and vice versa. So this is just a schematic view of the review process that I think all of you know. So the papers arrive and there is this internal review. So as an editor, our first work is to decide to send the papers out to review or not. How do we do that? So first of all, we read the paper and we check previous publication of the authors to see if there is something very similar that they have done, to be a PRL, it should be like pretty new, respect previous work. So you usually do not consider follow-up work. We check previous paper that maybe you submitted to us and they got rejected. So we have access to all report, to all the previous correspondence. We check the literature. And so we make an evaluation. And most of the time, we also consult with the divisional associate editor. So from this process, 70% of the papers got out for review. We allow two rounds of review. This usually means one major resubmission of the papers. And in exceptionally, we might consider a third round of review, but this is mostly done usually when there are really minor changes that have to be introduced to the article. And 20% of the paper get accepted in PRL, and from the rejected paper, most of them get transferred to specialized journal. Mostly for us, it happens that go to the other physical review. And just a very, very small fraction of them goes on appeal, the author's request to appeal. And of this most fraction is really the 3% of the papers that get accepted. These are just few tips for the authors about what I said. So for me, it's very, very important to receive a cover letter because, as I said before, we receive a lot of papers. So when you have really a cover letter that is kind of two paragraphs and you can explain very quickly why you've done this work and why it's important, it's just really a good introduction to the paper itself. So, I mean, it's very important, I think, during the whole review process, there is a good communication between the editors and the authors. So if you have any concern, you should write to the editors because this is our job. And this starts from the cover letter. So So you should basically tell us why you've done the work. So the cover letter should be like more or less like the abstract, but maybe shorter. And you should focus more on how or why than how. It's very easy. We want just it should be really explaining in a very simple way your result. Without claiming too much, because we have many, many times people, these are real part of cover letter that I personally received. So many times people do claim really too much, and you should be concise. Because, I mean, it's fun to receive these kind of things, but basically I read a lot, and I don't know anything about the paper. But you shouldn't be too concise, because I should still understand what you have done from the cover letter itself. And another important thing is that, to explain why the results are new and important. This is it's very nice, for example, if you can try to cite some work of other authors in the literature that might be relevant to yours. Or if you have previous work on this topic, of course you should have previous work on this topic, but something that is, it might seem quite similar, it's nice that you mention to the editors and explain which are the differences. If you submitted a paper and revised this paper, but you made substantial changes, it's good that you mentioned that there was this previous submission that went out to review, that got rejected. You explained the changes, is there were report, you try to respond the report. It's good, because I'm going to check these things anyway. So actually, if you could explain directly which are the changes, it makes everything easier. Oh, yeah. And so headaches are really bad. But it's still a problem. I know, they're cute. You never know. So let's move on. So the review process basically consists of three major players. Two of them are interchangeable, that most of the time people forget about this, that are the authors and the referee. You always see, there are the authors, they always complain about the referees and vice versa, but then they exchange their roles, so this is rather peculiar to me. And then there is the editor. So what I do is, first of all, I read a lot. Papers, not just what we receive in PRL, and I have to handle the paper. I read, of course, I follow closely the literature of the area that I handle for PRL, and then you check the reports, you read the resubmission. And so really, at the end of the story, an editor can be an effective reviewer in terms of readability and accessibility of the paper, broad interest in a general way. So it's most of the time we can also like send the papers back to the author saying this is not well explained, because you know a letter has to be like understandable by non-specialists too. And of course we try to make sure that the review process is pretty fast. So on average from submission to acceptance, an average PRL takes no more than 4 months. That is quite good. Oh, yeah, and this is a very nice sentence, actually, that describes the review process, at least to me, that since all the parties involved are human beings, but scientific research has a lot of doing about validation, and it's kind of like paradoxical that there is a trust component, and without this trust component, the review process might not work. And this is a serious problem, not a lot maybe in physics, but in other fields it is, because there is one thing that I personally cannot do and the referees cannot do, so is the authors present false data. So data fabrication is a big problem. And unfortunately, this is something that we need to trust the authors on this. And the authors also should kind of trust the editors to select the best possible referees available to review their paper at the time, without any personal interest, because we do represent the whole community, so we don't make any kind of preferences and so. The referee. So, where do we look for? Mostly our database. That this is actually important part of my job, is to keep the database updated. That right now counts more of 60,000 active referees. What you do not want in a journal like ours is just to have always the same people reviewing the paper. So actually we also check the referees that the author suggest, but we do not consult co-authors, previous collaborators, people working at the same institute, and usually 60% of the times the referee suggested falls in these categories, but I might check them anyway because they can be good researchers, so it's good to keep the database updated. We check related articles of yours, so if you have submitted something to us and it's very similar and needs that maybe the previous referee, it's really the best person to review the papers as well. And of course, we check references that for me are very, very important. I mean, maybe are the third things that I check when I receive the paper. The first is the cover letter, the second is the abstract, and then the references, because you just have like a frame for the article. You understand which is the previous work done and so on. So as you can see, as most of the papers that we publish are from Europe, actually, most of the referees that we use are outside of the United States, and this gives like an it shows like how international we are as an organization. And you can ask us to exclude referees if you want that some individual, okay, I'm doing this quite often, get excluded from the review process. And we do this. We always try to honor this request. We also exclude people that are close collaborator, that are the same institute, but you should be reasonable because you cannot exclude a whole country of from the review process, because especially for small, from small topic, when you exclude our country, you exclude basically 60% of the people working on that topic, and the other 40% are your co-authors. So we need the papers to be reviewed. So what do we want? Okay, so this is, I wanted to say, we try to encourage like senior researcher and a professor to start writing joint report with young researcher, and not student, but maybe PhD students at the end of their PhD, because I think it's very nice that if someone can teach a young researcher how to write a good report, because I mean, when I started, I had no idea on how a good report looks like. Now I know, because I just read many of them. So you, first of all, you should give, you should explain the result, because it's important for the authors to understand that you first read the paper and that you understood what they have done. Then we'd like you to give us a recommendation about the paper that can go from rejection, minor revision, And if you can address our criteria, that will be very nice. It's important to the editor. If you don't, I'll send you another email and ask you to address our criteria. And then usually what happens sometimes in PRL or just this kind of journal is that if you think that the paper is not suitable to be published with us, the report many times stops there. But I think it is always nice to give the authors some comments and criticism and help them to like improve the papers, even if it's going to be published somewhere else. So just always just give some comments on really how to improve the paper. So, and we like referee that can substantiate their arguments. So explaining us why we should reject or not the paper. And these things usually appears in the comments for the editors. So they're just for me. We don't send them to the authors, but they're rather nice. So for example, what can I say? If you decide to decide this is not new as done before, so it's not new enough for PRL, it will be nice, for example, if you cite some work that gives some references so the author can understand. And you should have a reasonable level of details in your effort, like this. That was very cute. It's my favorite. Yeah, we are all human. Don't shake your head. I have a collection of these. And with no personal self-serving remark. Now, no, this is serious. One very bad thing. Is when you try. So this was actually quite nice. It was a good admission. So I had to check that to make sure that we didn't publish that paper actually. But for example, it's not nice when you kind of force the author to cite your own work, even if it's not really relevant from what they did. And yeah, we try to be fast. So now I know, after 3 years, that when the Real World Cup to European Championship, I never have to consult someone from Europe because it doesn't work. Last year there was a referee from Brazil that says no, I mean our university are busy everywhere. I mean they are training. But he suggested other two people working in Brazil. I say, how it comes, you are the only one not working. But usually for a report, we wait till, so we send the first reminder after 2 weeks, and then other two reminders after 1 week and 1 week. So in total, we expect around 4 weeks. After that, we decide to move on and consult someone else, usually. So actually, if you receive a review request, it would be nice if you reply and give an estimate amount of time on how long it might take. Because if you're going, what we really don't want is that wait 1 month and then ended up without a report. It's not really for me, but it's really not fair to the authors. But sometimes might happen. And other things, what we do not consult as a referee, usually people that are direct competitors that we might know and you indicate, people in the acknowledgement of the papers and previous collaborators. So to recognize really the public service of scientists that have been really exceptional in addressing and reviewing our manuscript, the EPS has established the Outstanding Referee Program, and these are a list of people from Sweden that got this this reward. And we really believe that refereeing is a responsibility that comes with being part of a scientific community. You might disagree when you have a lot of work to do and we ask you to review a paper, but there are other people that are reviewing than your paper that you're writing. So it's how the scientific community works. And so how long does it take? As I said, sometimes we can be very, very fast. It depends really on the importance of the paper. When we get very important results, we have many things. There are many things we can do to accelerate the review process, like fast-tracking, asking the referee to report in 5 days or no more than 1 week, calling the referee, and so on. But on average, so this is the time that a manuscript stays with in the review process. So in blue is the time that it stays in the office. So this doesn't mean just with the editors, also with the production department. In red is the authors, and in green is with the referee. So most of the time the paper is or with the authors or with the referee. And also we, contrary to other journal, not all of them, of course, but we don't have a deadline or resubmission. So if you, I mean, you can even resubmit after 3 years now, then how novel your paper will be after 3 years, I don't know. So I'm not sure if there will be good chance, but still, you can take up to 1 year, to 2 years. I mean, after 10 years, the paper becomes inactive, though, automatically. So, after publication, you are a very good company. So, because then really the number of papers cited by the Nobel Prize Committee that have been published in PRL are really, really, the list is really, really long. These are the four of the papers that were listed in the report of the Nobel Prize Committee for the Nobel Prize in Physics this year on topological spaces of matter. Again, all those these milestone letters are easily accessible from our website, are free to read. And this is the entire list of the papers that we have published and that were awarded with the Nobel Prize, both in physics and in chemistry, actually. So all of this seminar work are available for you. So after acceptance, how do we highlight our best result? So we have several ways, not many, but several. So we have the cover images that it's changed every week. And these are figures that is contained one of the papers of the that we publish. We have editor suggestion that actually we do control as editor. And then there is this online publication of the APS physics, the highlight paper featuring three kind of articles that are viewpoints, synopsis, and focus stories. And we send regularly, this means weekly, tipships to the press. We collaborate with several newspapers, very important newspapers, that actually do love fundamental physics. So this is a collection of the, well, they just selected four of them, and the cover letter, the cover images, and as I said, it changes every week. Many times the picture is picked because it's a nice picture. Most of the time, though, we might select a picture because it's related to a very, very important result that we wanted on a cover. Oh, and recently we appear on the Big Bang Theory in one episode. They have a scientific committee, and you can see here, this is really the cover of PRL, both the new one and the old one, so we were really happy to see that. And so these are, as I say, the editor suggestion. We usually allot 1 in 6 paper for suggestion, and usually these are important, very important result in its own field and well-written paper. So the readability for a suggestion is very important because it's a kind of a recommendation that the editors make, gives to our readers. If you want to check something that is slightly outside of your field of expertise, these are very, very well-written papers. And as I said, physics highlights three kinds of articles, viewpoints, synopsis, and focus stories. So viewpoint are the collection of our best result. I'll show you statistics later, but these are usually commentaries written by scientists, active scientists working in their own field, that we usually ask them to explain the result to other scientists. So they can be rather technical, but not too much. The synopsis are short commentaries written by the editors, and instead the focus stories are written by professional scientific journalists. So they are really for the broad. I mean, even for non-scientists, they are very, very easy to follow and read. So, and this is what the press receive weekly from our deputy editor Matteo Rini. A collection of the nicest or most important results. There are many, many journals that subscribe to the APS and then they receive Discovery Weekly. So, as I said, these are the metrics. So, editor suggestion, as I said, 1 in 6 papers are suggestion is 15% of our articles. We publish 2,500 papers per year. Synopsis are very important result. 4.2% of the papers we publish are synopsis. And viewpoints are results that are likely to be very, very influential. So you see here, these are the numbers of letters published from 2012 until 2016. This is when we start reinvigorating our standard after the journal was reviewed by a scientific committee. And so we just try to reduce a little bit the number of papers that we publish, but still the number is quite tight. And this is the number of highlight though during the year. Still, the choice is quite relatively arbitrary in the sense that we do pick the result, but we make this decision based on the reports, recommendation of experts. So the number, the bulk of the very important results is still here, actually increased a little bit. And in terms of statistics, all the highlights are relatively to an average PRL, are cited like twice as often as a regular letter. For the viewpoint is actually the number of citation is even higher, and all these papers are really regularly covered in press. So do we have time still? So, So I'll talk a bit about journal metrics. Like, I think I introduced just two, the impact factor, the H index, with the intent to explain that these are journal metrics, not metrics of the importance of the paper itself, of a paper itself, or of a researcher. So in this plot, you see, we collected from Thomson Reuters 3,000 titles of journals that publish just physics. So we exclude multidisciplinary review journals because they usually, collect different things. From this plot, we also exclude journals that have an impact factor that publish less than 50 papers per year and that have an impact factor that is smaller than two. There are many, many of them. So the fact, so in this plot, there is the impact factor of 2015 versus the number of papers published by the journal per year. So excluding these two categories will just decrease the number of points in this area, but I'm just putting some name letters and otherwise will be too crowded. So the impact factor in 2015 is the average number of citation in 2015 of paper published in 2014 and 2013, average being divided by the number of paper published in those 2 years. So first things is a retroactive metrics. So it doesn't give the impact of the journal in that specific year, that is the immediacy index. So for example, PRL with 2,500 articles per year has an impact factor of 7.6. The immediacy index is around 2.3. That has the average number of citations on that year of paper. I mean, it takes a while for a paper to get cited. PRB, as I said, is the largest journal of the APS, around 50,000 articles per year this year. And this is actually, I put here a review journal. Review of Modern Physics is the review journal of the APS. So review journal usually publish very, very, very few articles, as you can see, and they get a large number of citations. Actually, if you want to boost your personal H index or impact factor, do publish a review article. But this is just to make a point that these denominators here, it's very important it really determines the impact factor. So what you can see here actually is that there is, after this point, there are after this corner, there are no points. There is just this blue area here. So this tells you that there are no physics journals that publish more than 1,500 papers per year that have this impact factor larger than 10. Or they publish more than 200 papers per year and have an impact factor larger than 15. So large impact factor are possible for small journal, and this is an editorial decision. It's okay, you can have a very small journal, selective journal with an high impact factor, you can have a journal like this average size with PRL, and have an impact factor that is around 7.6. We know that for what we publish, that is definitely more than 1,500 articles per year. We won't reach an impact factor above 10, for example. a double-digit impact factor, but we are happy with what we are. But this is, for example, a pretty other journal, just to give an example. If you take, for example, the PRL suggester, they say 15% of what we publish, technically you will have a journal that is the size of Nature Physics, of Nano Letters, with a comparable impact factor. And if you take the viewpoints, you are here. So what I'm saying, it was my point, is that, I mean, lately there have been a lot of discussion on how to evaluate people, performance, research. Everything is okay, but these are journal metrics. So you can have a very, very important results, like the one that we publish in our viewpoints, right? That is in a relatively big journal, actually even bigger than PRL. And of course, I mean, they shouldn't really be used to evaluate the performance of a researcher or to make hiring decision, right? And as a counterexample, indeed, I'll give you the H-index. So the H-index for a journal works really as the H-index from a researcher. So H is equal to the number of papers in the list that have N or more citation. So while the impact factor, of course, favors smaller journal, the H-index favors larger journal. And according to Google Scholar, Physical Review Letters is the first journal in physics. Again, the point is that these are journal metrics. You can use it, do whatever you want, but you have to understand what they are conveying. And again, they are for journals. They are not for researchers. If you want to read more about the topic, one of our division associate editor, Carton Caves, wrote this very, very nice article on APS News, so about the high impact factor symptoms that he called. It's very interesting. And yeah, so I hope that I gave you an overview of the journal and convince you to publish important results with us. If you're not convinced, you can always ask LIGO why do they decide to publish the first direct observation of the gravitational waves with us. And there is actually a very nice stories published. But the reason we think, well, there are two. First of all, we don't publish just the final discovery, the final observation. We did support the collaboration, publishing previous result, calibration of the instrument, and other things. And then they simply put it on a vote. So the majority of the people in the collaboration decide to publish in Physical Review Letters. And if you have any questions, I'm here. Thank you.